Is there any place you'd rather be than in worship this morning? Amen? Amen. Stuff to talk about. We will be going out Wednesday, Chainsaw. Again, if you have time and you'd like to come throw a chainsaw with us, that would be great. But we have great need for folks to pull the branches as well. We will be leaving here at 8 o'clock on Wednesday morning, and we will be returning, I say by 5, but I'm going to tell you that our chainsaw team is running out of energy about 2:30. We're usually back by about 3:45. So, this November marks the 10th anniversary of Operation Christmas Child drop-off location. Please continue to pack the shoeboxes for OCC and make donations for our church packing party. This month, we continue to focus on collecting school supplies, crayons, colored pencils, scissors, pencil sharpeners, and hygiene items, bar soap, washcloths, combs, and brushes. Did you have more that you wanted to add this week? Well, thank you. Pack a box at home. Boxes available at the welcome desk. Pack boxes either Sunday morning service during October, during either morning service during October, after either service. Groups will be limited to 4 people each time. Masks will be required. Visit the OCC website to build your box online from the comfort of your home. Yes. Contact Kat in the office. They want to sign up for the after-service bundling. Awesome. This is teamwork. I like it. And we're after 1,010 shoeboxes. How many did we do last year?
987, I think.
We'll get there from here. Let's see. The clothing closet will be open on Monday mornings from 8 to 12. Masks are required, no children in the room, and they are now accepting winter donations only, especially winter jackets. And I believe that's all I have to announce. Y'all, let us sit back, let us be right with God, and let us worship this morning.
Let us pray together. Look upon us, O Lord, and let all the darkness of our souls vanish before the beams of thy brightness. Fill us with holy love, and open to us the treasures of thy wisdom. All our desire is known unto thee, therefore perfect what thou hast begun. And what thy Spirit has awakened us to ask in prayer, we seek thy face. Turn thy face unto us, and show us thy glory. Then shall our longing be satisfied, and our peace shall be perfect. Amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. We most earnestly beseech thee, O thou lover of mankind, to bless all thy people, the flocks of thy fold. Send down into our hearts the peace of heaven, and grant us also the peace of this life. Give life to the souls of all of us, and let no deadly sin prevail against us or any of thy people. Deliver all who are in trouble, for thou art our God, who settest the captives free, who givest hope to the hopeless and help to the helpless, who lifteth up the fallen, and who art the haven of the shipwrecked. Give thy pity, pardon, and refreshment to every Christian soul, whether in affliction or error. Preserve us in our pilgrimage through this life from hurt and danger, and grant that we may end our lives as Christians, well-pleasing to thee and free from sin, and that we may have our portion and lot with all thy saints. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you. As we have received grace and love in Jesus Christ, let us share Christ's peace with one another. Amen.
Our scripture today comes from Psalm 145, verses 3 through 8. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love.
I love this walk-up music thing. Sorry, I'm turning my back to you people. I know this is like against all show business rules, but you'll just have to bear with me for a moment. We had a slight leak in here. All right, I think we're okay. I'm just gonna put this down here so we don't get a bunch of water on the table. It's too nice to ruin. All right, so Jesus is gonna say a pretty cool prayer this week. Is this our last week of prayer? This is it. It's not the last week of prayer, but it's the last week that Pastor Phil's talking about prayer. So this glass here has got some high quality Manchester H2O in it. This thing broken? All right. So, this glass is going to represent the world, okay? And this represents the water, all the people in the world, okay? So, as people in the world, we mess up, right? Well, that's really green. Okay, so as you can see, we've clouded it up. Our lovely world. Now, as Christians, how many of us think that we are not supposed to live of this world or in this world? We're supposed to completely separate ourselves of the worldly things. Is that true or false? Somewhat true, maybe. Okay. So Jesus, he's going to tell a great prayer to God here when Pastor Phil gets up and talks about scripture. So we are as people not called to be completely of this world, but be in this world, right? And we are supposed to go about Jesus's ways by showing a different light to people. So, as we are in this world, but not completely looking the same as everybody else in this world, we are the oil, okay? So we put a little oil in here. When a little's good, a lot's better, right? So we'll put a little more in there. Really trying not to make a mess everywhere in here. Okay, so if I can get this back on here, hold tight. Okay, as you'll notice, the water separates from the oil. And if I set this down and let it sit for a good long while, it would completely separate. Now, we talked about the glass being the world, right? So everything is still inside the glass. We have the water, we have the not so good things that people have done, and then we have all the Christians. We're all in this world together. But as we go through our activities, our daily lives, our schoolwork, our whatever it may be, God calls us to look different. Even though that we are of the same world as everything else, we should look different. So as we're hanging out with our friends, people should be able to tell that we are Christians. And it's awesome. And Jesus, when he gets into this prayer here, he makes it really cool. He says, Lord, I know that I'm not going to be here. I have to go up to heaven. But please be with all of my people here on earth, because I know they're not coming with me just yet. So if you'll bow your heads in prayer with me quick. Dear Lord, thank you for your example. Thank you for calling us to look different. Maybe not exactly physically. I mean, everybody looks differently already, but in our actions, Lord, whether it be through our word and our deed or just helping out our neighbor. We are of this world and we are in this world and we are not perfect, Lord, but help us just to be that example to your kingdom in this place. We love you. We thank you. Amen.
As Zach mentioned, we are completing our journey through Jesus' prayer today. I would like you to take a look at the wonderful work that our chancel crew has done putting together this visual. And I've asked you at the beginning, I said, pay attention to Jesus' hands as he comes from the water, as he prays in a quiet place. This one is particularly awesome. I'm kind of hoping that this might make its way to my office. Jesus, having the demon leave the boy as the scribes stand in the back in judgment. Isn't that cool? And today you got Jesus' hands wrapped around the world. If you'll notice that today's scripture is 26 verses, I will tell you that I do not, in memory, have a sermon that I have left more stuff on the cutting room floor than I did on this one. Or we were going to be here till like Tuesday. I'm serious. I had to settle down. It's just so much here. So I hope that I can do it justice. Also, in the midst of this. You know, I don't know about y'all, but I'm having one of those weeks that just seems to be just racking for my attention. Y'all know what I'm talking about? I just seem to be distracted. Anybody else like that? Just, there's enough going on, you know. You got COVID issues. We've got church issues with the conference. Not really issues, but lots of changes. And I have a relationship that means a lot to me that I'm kind of struggling with at the moment. And You know, I'm just kind of distracted. So let's enter into a time of prayer. And let's make this be a time all about God, God's word, and moving nearer to God's presence. Let's do that now. Holy and loving God, we thank you so much for this time you've given us to be here together. And Lord, I ask you to just enter into this place. Lord, the world calls to us from so many different places. We have anxiety around a pandemic. We have anxiety around elections. We have anxiety around civil unrest. We have anxiety around changes in our workplaces. We have anxiety around everything, which ultimately ends with anxiety in relationships as well. Lord, we pray for those relationships. We pray for our country. We pray for the world in this pandemic. Lord, we ask you just to help us to rest during this time here in the sanctuary. Help us to rest and set all other things aside and be focused fully on you. And Lord, as I lead in this time, I ask you, please, allow me to diminish so that you are revealed all the more. Lord, we love you. Amen. The prayer that we're going to talk about today falls within what is known as Jesus' farewell discourse, which begins in chapter 14 and runs up to his arrest. This prayer that we're going to focus on today is also known as the high priestly prayer, as Jesus shares with the Father all that he has accomplished through the Son's earthly ministry and all that is yet to come. This prayer takes place perhaps in the Garden of Gethsemane, though it is not given a specific place. As you follow the timeline, it should be right about there. But it's shortly before Jesus' arrest and the beginning of his dark night. Jesus has already predicted his death many times, including earlier this very night. Jesus has made it clear he knows what is to come, and this is the prayer of Jesus beneath the shadow of the impending cross. This is perhaps, and certainly in my opinion, the greatest prayer recorded in the Bible. 16th century theologian Philip Melanchthon wrote of this special prayer, "There is no voice which has ever been heard, either in heaven or earth, more exalted, more holy, more fruitful, more sublime than this prayer offered by the Son of God himself." A person's innermost being is revealed in genuine prayer. This is a unique opportunity to see the nature, character, heart, and love of Jesus. And Jesus, in this prayer, Jesus touches on many of the themes that are developed in the Gospel of John. Glory, to glorify, to be sent, to believe, which is a huge part of John. Speaking to the world of peace and love. Listen to this prayer as Jesus prays for strength and hope in the shadow of the impending cross. John chapter 17, beginning in verse 1. After Jesus said this, he looked toward heaven and prayed, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all the people, that he might give eternal life to all those who you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, you gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me." The first thing that I want to point out is at the beginning of the prayer. It seems like a small note, but this time, as I read it again for the 100th time or something, something caught my attention. Jesus goes into prayer, but he does not do what we do. If you noticed, he doesn't fold his hands, he doesn't bow his head, he doesn't close his eyes. He looks up to heaven, he opens his hands, and he speaks to God with a confidence of the intimacy of the relationship he shares with the Father. I thought that was amazing. Dare we ever be so bold? Jesus first prays for himself, though his petition is not selfish. His concern for himself is that his ministry and his sacrifice bring glory to the Father. Theologian Donald Carson writes, it will bring no glory to the Father if Jesus' sacrifice on the cross is not acceptable, or if the Son is not restored to his rightful place in the presence of the Father's unshielded glory. That would mean the divine mission had failed, the purpose of grace forever defeated. Jesus prays, the hour has come. What hour is this? The time of Jesus' crucifixion upon the cross. Isn't it interesting that this sacrifice, in the most painful and gruesome and shameful way man can think of to do, shall be an instrument of glorification in God's eyes? Are we willing to embrace and testify God's glory, even when the world may see it as humiliation? This is why I'm often bothered by some progressive theologians who diminish blood atonement. Blood atonement is that it is through the sacrifice that Christ has the ability to share his righteousness with those who believe. Were you to remove blood atonement, then you diminish the sacrifice and the story of the cross, the glory of the cross. That's something that causes me much concern, because it's cheap grace, and thus it's no grace at all. Theologian Merrill C. Tenney writes, how does the cross glorify the Father? The Son glorified the Father by revealing in the act the sovereignty of God over evil, the compassion of God of men, and the finality of redemption for believers. Then Jesus proclaimed that he has become the way of eternity. Having taught and encouraged the disciples as much as he could on the eve of their despair, Jesus now does a great thing. He commits them to the Father in prayer. Verse 6, I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world, and they were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Jesus is speaking of the 12. Theologian David Guzik writes, they have kept your word. When we think of all the failures and disappointments from the disciples, this is a kind assessment of Jesus. He generously judges his disciples. You know, I think back to the times when Jesus was frustrated. Get thee behind me, Satan, is one that comes to mind off the top of my head. But Jesus affirms to his Father with assurance, they know that you are the one who have sent me. They have believed your word and they trusted it. He is generous in his judgment. In verse 7, Jesus affirms that his disciples know and are assured of his divine presence and authority. We say that, but then what is soon to happen? In just moments, as Jesus is arrested, the disciples turn and run away and they hide. Again, Jesus is generous, affirming of his disciples. Jesus prays to the Father, they revere you because they know me. I have manifested your name to the men. Jesus did not simply teach about the name or the character of God, but he manifested, he displayed the character of God. The disciples know what is right, what is holy, by their experience of living in the presence of Jesus. Theologian David Guzik writes, they have known surely that I came forth from you. They may not understand everything, but they believe in the divine origin of Jesus and his teachings. Picking up verse 9. I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me. For they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. The glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be the one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by that name you gave me. None have been lost except the one doomed to destruction, so that scripture would be fulfilled. 19th century theologian C. Campbell Morgan writes, when Jesus says, I do not pray for the world, it is not out of unconcern for the world's plight. It was because of a focus on his own disciples. He was praying for the instrument he was creating through which he would reach the world. Have you ever stopped to consider the origins of your faith? Many of us came to faith because our parents shared it with us, or a family member, or in my case, it was friends. But somewhere, I learned of my faith from another. I didn't just sit down, read the Bible, and say, amen. I've told this story before. The first time I sat down and read the Bible, I said, that's insane. I didn't understand a word of it. Am I alone on that? Can I get an amen? Okay? No, we needed someone to share the gospel story with us. And for them to be able to share the gospel story with us, it had to be more than mere words. It also had to be shared within their witness as well. Isn't that true? Have you ever stopped to consider the origins of your faith? Jesus is praying for his disciples because if you were to do the work of the genealogy of your faith, you must find that faith's origin rests with one of these disciples. Those who shared the words and deeds of Jesus generation to generation, so that you may believe and know of the grace through repentance and the assurance of eternal life through resurrection. Jesus is praying for the 12, knowing that they are going to be the catalyst of that which will become the church. And all of us, in one way or another, as we trace our faith, they told me, they told them, they told them, they told them, they told them, we eventually will come to a place where it's one of these disciples who first shared their faith so that we could believe. Does that make sense? So Jesus prays for his disciples, for their safety, for their eternity, and for their courage to overcome the world for the glory of the next. Let us focus for a moment on verse 12b. None has been lost except the one doomed to destruction, so that scripture would be fulfilled. None has been lost but the one doomed. I've often wondered about that verse. The original Latin translated from Greek is Filius Perditionis, the son of perdition. When translated to German, it was Das Verlorene Kind, the lost child. This is in reference to Judas. My struggle has always been, if his betrayal was foretold, and it was needed to fulfill scripture, and it was required, then why is he the one lost, the doomed? Judas' inspiration for betraying the Savior was self-motivation, and God knew what Judas was going to do. God knew Judas's character, and he knew his character flaws and his need for personal attention. This was required, but Judas did not accept Jesus as a spiritual Messiah, and he did not see himself as one who was in need of a personal Savior. Make no mistake, Judas is lost. Hebrews chapter 6, beginning in verse 4. It is impossible for those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, who have shared in the Holy Spirit, who have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the powers of the coming age, and who have fallen away, to be brought back to repentance. To their loss, they are crucifying the Son of God all over again and subjecting him to public disgrace. Pick it up in verse 13. I'm coming to you now, but I say these things while I'm still in the world, so that they may have full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the word has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me in the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I sanctify myself, for they too may be truly sanctified. Jesus reveals that he is confident that God hears his prayer and will deliver a positive response. And because of this, Jesus will know true joy. Jesus knows that God is near, and the message of grace through repentance will threaten many of this world, and they shall resist. They will not easily yield their self-defined authority. Jesus prays, I know they can't come with me now. They have work to do, but protect them from this world. They are no longer of this world, as I am not of the world. Though the human condition exists, these disciples will be governed by faith. We see the human condition in these disciples often as they misunderstand Jesus' parable, as they want to call down fire on another who is baptizing, but not in Jesus' name, as they question Jesus' decisions, get thee behind me, Satan. Again and again and again, these disciples seem to falter at full understanding of what Jesus is trying to tell them. But what Jesus is saying, it is not by their knowledge that they are governed, it is by their faith. They make mistakes. They may step out in a wrong direction, but they yield to Jesus' teachings when he calls them back and calls them into more. We see the human condition as they run and hide after his arrest. We see their spiritual commitment when they return to the empty tomb and when they preach from the temple steps in Acts chapter 2, boldly in front of all of those who cried, crucify. Jesus sanctifies. He pays the price for atonement so that they shall be sanctified. This is where Jesus proclaims that he shall share his own righteousness. He will trade his righteousness for the stained righteousness of humanity. The basis of Jesus' request is rooted in the name and character of God. God is glorified by the completion of his work in us. Picking up verse 20. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray for those who will believe in me through their message, and that all of them may be one. Father, just as you in me and I am in you, may they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them glory the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. This is a scripture of major importance. Jesus does not pray for the disciples alone, but for all who have experienced their ministry through word and deed and believe. Are they a people of one mind? No. Are they a people of one action? No. But that they be a people of one heart found in faith? Yes. And in one faith, God is glorified and humanity is saved in faith because they believe. Right beliefs. Theology matters. The world calls us out, and you know, as Christians, we are in a place where through faith and through love, we should be able to listen to each other. And you might be a person who only eats vegetables. I don't understand you. I can't fathom what that would be like. But you can choose to do that if you want to. Not going to bother me. If you want to talk to me about why I should not eat meat, I can listen to you. I can respect your opinion. But can we part as friends if I disagree? That's the heart of faith. But there are certain things that are not negotiable. We are often told that we must negotiate here and there, and if we're over here and they're over there, the right answer has to be where, someplace here in the middle. And I'm here to tell you that is not true. That is not accurate. There are supreme, absolute truths. One, Jesus saves. He's not a possible savior. He's not one potential answer as a savior. He's not a choice towards salvation. Jesus is the way of salvation. I will stand on that. Now, if you have a different opinion and you want to share that with me, I will listen to you. And then I will share you my point of view. And through a heart of faith, we can part and still be friends. But it does not mean that I need to migrate towards their opinion. Does that make sense? There are some absolute truths. When Jesus is talking about all in one, he's saying, Father, you have the word. You are the one who defined creation. You defined, you are the author of love and grace and hope and life and love. You did that. Okay? For me to be in relationship with you is for me to accept the way that you define that. Okay? That doesn't mean that we have to be of one mind, but it does mean that we have to acknowledge one God. Does that make sense? So when God says this is the path that is right, and I'm not talking about the things that we fight about. We understand that, right? We're in this great fight over politics. We're in this great fight over mask or no mask. We're in this great fight over immigration. We're in this great fight over sexuality. We're in this great fight over, y'all understand that's noise in the background. The focus is this: is God creator? Yes. Is Jesus Messiah? Yes. Did Jesus die on the cross to atone for our sins so that he can trade his blessed, pure righteousness with mine, which is ruined and stained? The answer is yes. I'm not giving you an opinion. I'm telling you what it says. And it's simple language. And yet we still seem to find ourselves struggling. Well, does that mean everybody? Yes. But they're different than me. I don't care. But they don't cheer for Iowa. God loves them too. People, we have got to come to a place where we understand what's important and we turn loose of the other stuff. I don't have to agree with you. Jonah, he builds an ark. Did the world flood? You tell me. I have an opinion. You can't change it. There is nothing that you can do to change my opinion. I think the world flooded. I think it was awesome. I wish I had a fishing pole. That was Noah. Jonah and the big fish. Did we really have a dude get eaten by a giant fish? What do you think? How many of you buy into that? You don't have to admit it. I'm going to tell you, I totally buy it. Why? Because if I was God, I would think that was cool. It works for me. So I think there was a giant fish. If you don't think so, I don't care. We can talk about it. You're not going to change my mind. I may well not change yours. And when we walk away, what can we be? Friends. Why? Because it's not a part of the salvation message. That is what he's trying to say. He is trying to tell you. He's trying to bring us into a prayer about what's important. And it's not the background noise. Yes, he speaks to such things, but are they a part of the salvation message? No, they are not. What is a part of the salvation message? It is really simple. You guys need to understand, I went to school for a really long time to learn just a few absolute truths. God is God, creator, Jesus, savior, repentance, grace, eternal life. And y'all, I got A's. That's as complicated as it gets. Do you believe in that which is important? The rest of it is noise. But we'll talk about it, and if we disagree, we walk away that big dummy. What's wrong with them? Oh, the ones I love best. If you don't agree with me, you're not Christian. Really? Is that really the way this works? I may disagree with your politician. I may disagree with your stance on some of the big issues of the day. But can we agree that God is creator? Jesus is Savior. We can know repentance and grace. We know salvation. And thus we will live together eternally. Y'all, we better find a way to get along quick, because eternity is a really long time. Jesus' prayer is about what's important. We understand the human condition exists. As humanity, we've got this. For 2,000 years, Jesus has been saying, greed, bad. Is there greed in our world today? Sure, absolutely. What have we learned? Diddly. Rage, bad. Cut me off in traffic, I will witness to you, rage. We know the human condition exists, and we know that grace abounds. Can we not sense then step apart and allow God to be God? And for us to humbly allow God to lead. I'll get back to my notes, I'm ranting. Through faith in the final assessment, we will be unified with complete understanding when we join together with our feet beneath the kingdom table. Theologian David Guzik writes, our continuing on in Jesus is not left to our own efforts alone. The world, the flesh, and the devil are so mighty, so persuasive, and so seductive, we could never keep ourselves in our own efforts. If we stay with Jesus, it is because Jesus has prayed for us. If we stay with Jesus, it's because Jesus has prayed for us. Father, keep them. Pick it up in verse 24. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. Jesus prays again with the assurance that this prayer was or will result in a favorable action. I want them to be where I am. This is the promise of eternal life in the presence of our triune God, but it is not limited to that. It is also about faith, a maturity beyond belief in reliance, not with anxiety, but with joy in all situations. It is knowing the eternal peace and joy of holiness starting right now in this life. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. We pray it. Do we pray it like it's possible? Jesus again returns to the beginning. They know you because I've made you known. We know God through the teaching as well as the nature and character of Jesus Christ. Jesus prays with bold confidence. The world may declare he is wrong, but Jesus marches forth knowing he is right, directly into the shadow of the cross. As I stand beneath this cross in the sanctuary, I want you to close your eyes and imagine Jesus. With this prayer for God's glory to be declared in his life and ministry, a prayer for Jesus' disciples that they continue to remain blessed so that God's righteousness may be glorified, a prayer for all the believers through all time and in all places. In this moment, imagine Jesus, knowing what comes next, with eyes looking towards heaven, prays for you and me and to be glorified. Literally in the shadow of the cross to come. Church, shall we live so as to be an answer to Jesus' prayer? Are we committed to daily study of God's word? Are we committed to daily, passionate, and genuine prayer? Are we committed to sharing God's love story with humanity, not just the ones we like, but with all? Are we committed to loving God and one another through faith? Are we committed to being unified in faith so that we can encourage one another, listen to one another, and walk with one another? Are we so ready to live into our own faith maturity here in the shadow of the cross? Amen. Have a video for you, Russ Taff, The Shadow of the Cross.
From the dawn of creation to the end of it all stands the shadow of the cross, calling the children we all can come home by the shadow of the cross. Welcome the broken that be down on thee to the shadow. Come drink from life's fountain, come wash yourself clean in the shadow of the cross. He cried, "It is finished. I've given my life. The terrible price has been paid. The hope of the future, the present, the past. The hope of the future.
Talk about the support of the church. We will be moving into our Estimates of Generosity series. We'll begin next week, where you'll get a lot more information about what's been happening. The third week, our finance chair, Bruce Nordorfer, will do a special presentation. excuse me. But I will tell you in the short version, we are not at our budget. But our expenses, as you can guess, are significantly down due to, you know, we got a lot of the building shut down and so on and so forth. Financially, we're doing okay. We really are. We're in pretty good shape. I know a whole lot of churches that wish they were where we are. But that being said, it's time for us. I've challenged the circuit pastors. I said, I don't have an answer to this. I don't know what this means. I know that all of us, you know, when we started, when the pandemic first happened, the rest of them didn't have video capabilities, as you know, and so we all videoed from here and we rotated. And every church got to see their pastor every once in a while, and that was fantastic. And people started falling out as they were going back to live worship or as they picked up their own video capabilities. And that was great. And so now we're down to it's just us again, okay? So for those of you at home that are waiting to see one of the other fine pastors, sorry, you have to turn the channel. So now we've got all this stuff out on the public airwaves, right? Out of media. My question to you is this. I'm going to tell you a couple things I know that are just kind of curiously funny, okay? I got a phone call a few weeks ago. A friend of Brad Davis's, their church did not have video capability. They were feeling lost, didn't know what to do. Brad said, watch our pastor. And so now we have a church in Oklahoma that is watching us. Hello, Oklahoma, go big. Oh, yeah, no, oh, you lost. Yeah. anyway, Decay State. Anyway, I was called early on by a family member from one of our members. Their church didn't have anything in Wisconsin, and they didn't know what to do. And she said, watch our pastor. And so we have a church in Wisconsin. Go cheese. That's all great, okay? And our call is a worldly call. We are called to speak into faith and hope and encouragement, repentance and grace, so that all can believe and know eternal salvation. So wonderful that these waves are out there, but the problem is this. Our primary call is where? It's in our own community, in our own sphere of influence. And how do you drive people who are currently right now home and they're hopeless? They may be hurting financially because of the pandemic. They may be, and this is a very real thing, they may be dealing with some severe anxiety and depression over the isolation. And they don't know where hope is found. How do I get to them in my community? How do we speak hope to the hopeless in my community? I can't do my usual thing, which is, as you all know, I wander around town aimlessly and just talk to folks. That's my favorite thing to do. But I can't really do that right now. I go to the hospital and I'll see this patient and the patient next door. I'll pray with them as well. I can't really do that right now. All the things that I know of how to do in my old-fashioned, I remember dial-up. The kids are like, what's dial-up? I don't know how to do this thing that needs done. But I promise you, within a few blocks of this place right now, someone is hurting and crying out because they are lonely, they are depressed, or they're broken. How do I speak hope and the love of Christ into their lives? I don't know the answer to that. I challenged the circuit. I said, guys, we got to figure this out. And it may involve that we need to do some other things electronically. And I may come back and say, guys, we need to buy some equipment so that those without hope can believe, because that's our job. I don't know that's what I'm going to do. I have no idea what the answer is, but we're seeking it. So for those of you that know anything about this, I'm looking for ideas. Financially, the church is doing pretty well, but we still have needs to speak hope to the hopeless. So I ask you to remember to support the church with your offerings as you go out the door. The offering plates are on either side, and as you go out the back door, they're there as well. But y'all, I want to make sure you hear this. We are a generous people, and the church is really doing okay. With that, we're going to enter into my favorite time of service, when we get to act like family and share the stuff of our lives. What joys and concerns do we have as a congregation? Tom Allen, whose surgery is Wednesday, right? So let's keep Tom in prayer. Wilbur and Evelyn Everts. Larry Gorenson, your surgery is Thursday?
A week from Monday.
A week from, okay, we'll pray next week. We don't want to overpray. Danielle Nelson, Tammy Reth-Pentel, Susan Rogers, Tim Tutton is home, Brooklyn Weifel, Jen Hubner, Mary Bissell, Chris Jackson, Ellen Nistel, Tanya Smith, Troy and Lisa Tutton, Dean Weifel, Jim DeKeyser, Terry Dolan, Zach Fisher, Jeff Larson, John Rasmussen, Donna Tenoff, Bill Welcher. I've just received news that we've had an outbreak of coronavirus in Good Neighbor Home. There are 20 positives that I know of. They had just done 10 more tests. They were expecting it to go up. Three of them are hospitalized. And I'm not supposed to know this, but I do know that one of them are ours. Y'all, we just need to keep Good Neighbor Home in prayer. They fended this thing off for an awful long time. And let us continue to keep them in prayer. The young lady who we discussed last week for funeral expenses, I did get her permission. She had a very lucid day, and it is Tanya Smith. And we were able to raise about 80% of what we needed last week. We just got a little ways to go so that we know we've got that covered. But I was able to assure her that it's a done deal. We can take care of that. So if you feel so called, please, we just need a little bit more to funeral expenses as a special offering. Other joys, concerns, things we wish to pray about. Yes, ma'am. That's outstanding. That's outstanding. Now, she's still in a very aggressive chemo treatment, yes?
That I don't know for sure.
Okay.
And stress levels at the schools are at an all-time high amongst our teachers and administrators, so please, please keep them in prayer. A lot of them are reaching that breaking point.
That we're talking about, yeah. So Lisa Tutton got some good news, and we're going to keep her in prayer. And for the administration and the teachers at the schools, they're just feeling an enormous amount of anxiety. And as a youth pastor, I can tell you, you got all these kids running around, and they know you're your responsibility. And no matter how much they irritate you, they are their parents' most treasured possession. And so the anxiety goes up. So let us pray for our teachers, our administration, and certainly our students. Others? Yes, sir. Jeff has joined us in service. Praise the Lord. That is outstanding. It's good to have you back, brother. Okay. Others? Y'all, let's pray, shall we? Holy and loving God, we thank you for this time you've given us to be here together. And Lord, we wish to pray from the core of our being. Hear these prayers, Lord. For those who are coming to an end of this mortal life as they prepare for the transition to the kingdom table. Lord, we pray for them that they know encouragement and peace and be with their families as well. Lord, for those who are seeking to know you now in a time of healing, we pray for a double portion of healing grace. Lord, be glorified. And Lord, for those who are seeking to know you in a time of hopelessness or despair, brokenness, Lord, for the least and the lost and the hopeless, we pray for them right now. Lord, be made known to them. Let them hear where hope resides. Let them understand that the story is one that ends in victory. For those who believe, Lord, let them hear your truth. And Lord, if it be your will, guide our steps in whatever way we can in this current reality. Help us to share with them through our word and witness the truth of the gospel story. And Lord, for our world as we seem to struggle with civil unrest and with politics and with, oh Lord, look down upon us, we're a mess. Lord, help us to break up or to pick up the broken pieces and help us to put together a society again, one that is focused and centered in faith, where we can listen to each other and remain friends even when we disagree. Lord, this is our prayer. And we pray this with genuine heart, just as we pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Closing hymn. Morning of worship, and how blessed am I to be able to share it with all of you. Let us pray. Holy, loving God, we thank you for this time you've given us to be here together. And Lord, we pray with genuine hearts, lead us to be more mature disciples. Lord, lead us to be mature disciples who will share your glory and their witness with every day. A glory that is found in reading your word and in creating that close, intimate relationship through prayer. And Lord, for boldly standing, though in this world, apart from it. Lord, these are the things that we pray for, encourage, and embolden us. And Lord, hear this, our most passionate prayer. Created us to be vessels of your spirit so that others will experience you loving them through us. And Lord, let them say there is something truly special about Jesus. Lord, let them hunger to know you more. This we pray. We love you. Amen.